Today, we're in our sermon series. We started last Sunday. Thank you. We started last Sunday, Mind Wars. Say with me, Mind Wars. Oh, my gosh. You guys are half asleep. Say, Mind Wars. How many of us, and just wave at me if you've ever happened, if it's happened to you, if you don't really want to wave, you could do this. But how many of you have ever gone through things in your mind where you've battles in your mind and there's so many things? Okay, good. I don't feel alone here. I've struggled. I still struggle. Pastor Ruben, you struggle? Yes, I probably struggle more than you. So now it makes you human because I'm human. Are you with me? Just because we stand up here doesn't mean we're perfect. All right, maybe I'm not perfect, Lord. They don't care. But I care that I'm not perfect. Mind wars. And so because we struggle in our minds, it's important that we understand. And I want to give you some steps. I realized last week I opened it up by giving you some stats. You guys know I love to give stats and look at different things and how and why. And so I give you some stats on the brain. How many remember that? So some of you, I hope you started drinking a lot more water because your brain is 75% water. If you didn't know that. And so, and then some of you that say, I'm a multitasker. Actually, you're not. All you're doing is two different tasks at once, and it's taking you double the time. So just do one task, get it done, and move to the next one. Are you with me? There's no such thing as multitasking. Whoever invented that is wrong, because the neuroscientists have discovered that there's no such thing as multitasking. So all those stats. I decided today is in the next couple of weeks, I'm going to start giving you tools on how to clear your mind and how to keep your mind going forward so that you can be all that God created you to be. That's our third vision, right, third piece to our vision, right? Belong, believe, become. Become what? All that God has created you to be. I don't want you to be Pastor Ruben. I want you to be the best version of you that God called you to be, because there's no carbon copy of you. I know Brittany has a twin, but it doesn't matter. She could look like her, but she doesn't act like her. They're different. They have different. As a matter of fact, their fingerprint is different. You can have an identical twin. They can't. I heard this story of two identical twins. One was great in philosophy and the other one wasn't. And one had the philosophy class and then he went and took the test for his brother. And that's a great trick, right? He passed. His brother passed because they were identical twins. But if they were to take a fingerprint, the professor would have found out that actually that wasn't the person that was taking the class. That was his brother. Because you can be identical, and I may not be able to tell you apart, but there's something in your DNA that tells you apart. And so I say that because it's important that we understand that there is no two of you. You are unique. You're like one of a kind. Amen, right? Thank God, I'm one of a kind. Like some your spouse may be like, oh, I don't know. Like there can't be two of you. There is not. There's just one of me, and that's more than enough, right? And so I want to give you some tools. Say with me, tools to help us. And so Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I think it says Romans 2, but let's see. Can we go up to the scripture? I didn't look at my paper. Could we go to the scripture? Yeah, actually, sorry, that's the wrong scripture. My fault. It's Romans 12. Romans chapter 12. Verses 1 to 2, and that's why I'm glad I have my phone right here, because I could. Romans chapter 12, and the Bible says this. I'm going to be reading out of the Amplified. I love the Amplified version. Why the Amplified? Because it amplifies. It makes it sound louder. It increases the volume. That's what amps do. All right, so Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it says, therefore I urge, you say with me, I urge. So urging is kind of like, I'm kind of begging you. I'm urging you. When somebody says, I urge you, they're not just asking you. They're like, come on, we need to put a push on this. Okay? Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies, dedicating all of yourselves set apart. Here's why it's so important that you understand that we are in the world, but we're not of the world. Why? Because I'm set apart. I can't act like the world acts. This is why we have to be really, really, really careful with woke culture. Right? Because everybody want to be woke. We got to be really, really, really careful that you don't get inundated with what the world says. This is why, Pastor Ruben, this is why I want to turn this into a school. Because what they're trying to teach our kids now, I'm not putting my grandson, my granddaughter through that stuff. At kindergarten, they're trying to teach your kids certain things. First grade, they're trying to teach them. I have teachers here with me if you're a teacher. I got a couple teachers here, yes, that they teach in school. And I have Rosie, who's in New York, who she said, Pastor, I'm not teaching what that book is telling us to teach. And she teaches first graders. And, you know, we were talking to her a couple days ago, and she said, Pastor, what they're trying to tell us to teach, I am not teaching that. And so this is why I said, we need to make a Christian school here. And so guess what? We're already halfway there because the doors are already done. We got them ready so that when we have the city come in and they do a inspection, they're going to say, your doors are good. Now we got to upgrade some other things, but that's okay. We're starting. Why? Because I'm getting this ready for a school. I want to do a kinder to junior high. I want to help your kids out so we can teach them biblical truths, right? I have a vision, and it's vast. We're not ready for it yet, but we're getting ready for it. Are you with me? And so the Bible says that dedicating all of yourselves set apart. You can't be like the world. We have to set ourselves apart, right? The Bible goes on to say in verse 1, as a living sacrifice, holy and well-pleasing to God, which is your rational or your logical, intelligent act of worship. Did you know that we have to come to God with intelligent worship? This is why, this is some of the old school churches. This is what they would do. They would be like, who wants to sing? And then the lady would come up here that has no voice whatsoever. And then she would come up here and she'd be like, I don't know how to sing, but it's all for the glory of God. And it would drive me nuts. I'd be the worship leader, and I'd be like, then what the heck are you doing up here if you can't sing? Get your butt down there. Don't sing. Because all you're doing is hurting my ears, and I know every key on this keyboard, and I can't find your key. We give God leftovers of our worship, and we expect God to do something with it. No, he's giving you a gift. Now walk in your gift. If you can't sing, don't pick up a mic. Sing in the shower when nobody's listening. As a matter of fact, close the window so nobody outside can hear you. I don't want them to call the cops on you. Like, it sounds like a dead rat up in there screaming. Watch this. So our worship must be intelligent. Here it goes on to say in verse 2, and here it is. Here's my key verse for you. And do not be conformed, and do not be conformed, and do not be conformed to this what? World any longer with its superficial values and customs. That's the world we're living in right now. It's superficial. Everything on Facebook and Instagram is a lie. How many filters? Come on, ladies, I'm men too. How many of us got filters on our phones? Just please put your hand up. Exactly. Lies. And some of you are lying right now because you didn't raise your hand. You know, when you take a selfie, you're putting like 50, look, I got women in my house. I don't want to get my chin. Get it higher. How about we lose weight? We won't have to do all that stuff, right? I'm not talking about my wife. I'm talking about me. Because every time she's taking pictures of me. And I'm like, I don't like that one. Me, I don't like that one. Change it. Make sure I look good in the lighting. Put the high-res filter. Like, fake. That's the world. So don't believe everything you see on Instagram and Facebook. They're going to show you the best versions of what's going on. But really, there's something behind the scenes. And do not be conformed to this world any longer with its superficial values and customs, but be transformed and progressively changed. I love that. Progressively changed as you mature spiritually by the renewing of your minds. Focusing on godly values and ethical attitudes so that you may prove for yourselves what the will of God is. So that you may prove for who? Yourself what the will of God is. Stop trying to prove yourself to everybody. You just need to prove yourself to God. We live for the audience of one. If I was here trying to please you, I would never be able to please everybody. Because somebody, I always got something to say. So guess what? I don't care what you say. I'm going to dress the way I dress. I'm going to talk the way I talk. I'm going to drive what I drive. And I don't give a... That wasn't to yell, but... You know why? Because it's about God. Now, again, I love everybody because as a pastor, I need to love you. But if I cared about everything you said, then I would never move forward. If I cared about what everybody said, we wouldn't be purchasing a property next to us. Because they're going to say, well, we just got out of a pandemic. And some of you, the pandemic is still going on. But can I tell you this? That on Monday, we signed contracts because we purchased this property next to us. That in the middle of a pandemic, people are losing their properties, but we're buying property. Why? Because I'm not conforming to this world. I don't care what this world says. The world says there's a recession and gas is $10 a gallon. But I'm going to keep going forward because I know who my God is. I know the vision that he's given me. All right, are you with me? So let me give you some quotes that I got because it's so important. We're talking about mind words. Whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're right. Whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're right. That's Henry Ford. Teddy Roosevelt says it like this: believe you can and you're halfway there. Marcus Aurelius says this: the happiness of your life depends on the quality of your thoughts. Dale Carnegie says it like this: our thoughts make us what we are. So if you sit here and tell me that my mind doesn't matter, you're wrong. It matters everything. Whatever you're thinking about, remember we talked about this last week, between 12 and 60,000 thoughts per day, 80% of your thoughts are negative. So whatever you're thinking about has you. Whatever you're thinking about controls you. And this is why you need a renewing, a transformation of the mind. That's what the scripture says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed and progressively changed by the renewing of your mind. Here it is. Here's your first point. I'm going to give you several points. If you haven't downloaded the app, download the app right now. But this is important. Number one, it says, do not conform. Do not conform. Do not what? It's so important that we don't conform to certain things. What is so important is this, is that conforming means complying with rules, standards, or laws. It means to be similar in form or type. It means to agree. So do not conform to what? To the patterns of this world. This is why you can't agree with the world. This is why you need to agree with the word. I need to conform to the word, not to the world. Conforming is important because it means complying with what the world is complying with. It's standards. And the world says this, but the word says this. The world says this, and God says this. And you cannot conform to what the world is doing and saying. This is why I tell some of you, watch what you're watching online. The Black Lives Matter activist, the person that started it, she got into a lot of trouble. Number one, because she started buying multi-million dollar homes in white neighborhoods. And so everybody's talking about her because she's talking about Black Lives Matter, but her life is telling something else. But the world is following what she's saying, but she's not following what she's saying. And so then the churches get involved and everybody's getting involved. All of a sudden, wait a minute, we start conforming to the world. Who did Jesus die for? Everybody, right? Black lives, Latino lives, Asian lives, white wives, lives, Arab lives, everybody's life. So why are we conforming to one? Now I know I've been pulled over driving while brown. I have a pastor friend that that he was pulled over as a pastor in San Diego, Pastor Miles McPherson. He's black. He was pulled over and he was told a lot of things. And so he's been through it. But his mindset is saying, look, if I conform to the world, then I'm going to be just like the world. I know what Jesus did for me. I know the world we live in. But let me tell you something. If you work hard enough, you can reach your dreams and your goals. There's nobody stopping you but you. Come on, let's not live. Come on, I'm helping everybody in here. Because some of us are conforming. And saying, I can't do it because of the color of my skin. I can't. No, you can't. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I was at Home Depot and I was upset. Because there was an older Asian man and he was standing there. And there was an older white man. Look, racism exists. And he was coming in with a tool. And he was asking the worker, and it was two white, happened to be two white guys, this could be anybody, but it was two white guys, an older one and a younger one. And the Asian man is asking, hey, is there a baddie for this? And the older white man says, oh yeah, he didn't buy that here. He got it at the swap meet. And I stood there and I looked at him and I said, What do you mean? Cause I'm Pastor Reuben, but in the street, I'm just Rube Dog. I'm joking. And I said, what did you mean? And he looked at me and he didn't know where to go. Because racism exists. But I can't conform to this world and say, because I'm a believer, he's not. So what do you expect? It's important because if I allow that to inundate my mind, it's going to take over. So I have to not conform to this world, but conform to the word of God and say, okay, God, you love the world so much that you sent your son Jesus to die because this world is wretched. It's horrible. It's bad. And you came to die for that old white guy. He just doesn't know it yet. And so it's my job to tell him, what do you mean? And then tell him, show him the love of Jesus. Did I show him the love of Jesus there? No, I wanted to punch him three times. Because the older man wasn't defending himself, but I was going to defend him. And I had to check myself because I understood who I was. Are you with me? Come on, I'm just being transparent. I was going to share that story, but I want to be transparent with you that it happens. But we can't conform. Say with me, conform. Because there is a pattern that this world has and we can't conform to it. You with me? Watch this. The Bible says that we are to be Next slide. We are to be transformed by the what? The renewing of our minds. That's so important because I want you to get this because the word transformed, and I've said this many times, is the word metamorpho in the Greek. That word metamorpho is where we get the word metamorphosis. And I talk about this all the time. It's where the best explanation is when a caterpillar turns into a butterfly. It can never go back to being a caterpillar. Why? Because it's gone through the cocoon stage. The metamorphosis is what we call it. And so because it's gone through a metamorphosis can never change back. Here's what happens. This is what happens to some Christians. I don't call them believers, Christians. Because what happens with Christians, they love the feeling. Ooh, I like the way church feels. But all of a sudden the world calls them and they run back. Why? Because that wasn't metamorphosis. That wasn't transformation. All it was a change of heart. And I could change. Come on, some of you, you've been married 10 times. You could change your heart. You could change who you love. I love you today. I don't love you tomorrow. Because that's what we call change. That's not transformation. We are to be transformed by the renewing. So transformation is important. So if I don't transform my thinking, I'm going to stay the same. This is why some of us, I'm proud of myself. My wife will tell you, I'm doing this workout regimen, and somebody told me today, wow, Pastor, you look skinny. I said, yes. It's not only that I look skinny. I'm starting to get buff like James. I'm like, what's up? My neck is like. I took off my shirt yesterday. My nephew was at my house. He was visiting from Pennsylvania. I took my shirt off. He was like. I said, that's right. You better make that every time I take my shirt off. And he was probably saying, dang, Uncle, you heavy. He didn't say that, though. But I'm proud of myself because I've been working out. And I've been getting my, and I, this is the most energy I've had in years. And I realized it had to do with My mindset. I can sit here and tell you so many things, but there's that one thing that we all have that stops us from moving forward. We can think with the best of them. We can do all these things, and some of you are workout fiends, and some of you aren't. And some of you, you can eat with the best of them. And ain't nobody changing your mind. But there's something with the mind when you set your mind. Remember I talked about this last week? When you set your mind on a goal, when you set your mind on something, can't nobody change it. Nobody's going to change what you have to. And so that's how I decided with my health. I said, you know what? I'm going to have energy when I come to church because the church needs the best version of me. And so I want to be healthy because when we start buying this property and the next property and the casino, I got to have strength and energy to be able to run these things. When we have a school here, I got to have energy to make sure that our kids are being taught right. I'm telling you. So I need energy. So I started working out. Started taking my shakes, little jump rope. But it happened, watch this, with the transformation of my thinking. Because I started thinking of the future. And I said, I'm 47. My dad's 86, 80, 84 right now. He looks great. So I'm like, okay, God, if you give me 80-something years, that means I got 40-something years. I ain't got time to play. Listen, some of you are not thinking like that. You're thinking, well, I'm going to retire and this and this. You better start thinking how much lives you have left on this earth. And I heard a preaching yesterday, and Bishop T.D. Jakes was like, tick, tock, tick, tock. And he kept saying, tick, tock. And I was like, oh, my gosh. He says, some of you are wasting your time. Tick, tock, tick, tock. Every day you're wasting. And so you waste a day, and then you say, I got another day. And then you keep wasting and wasting and wasting. And then next thing you know, you got white hairs, and you're like, wait, I was just 20 years old. Now I'm 47. What happened with the time? Tick, tock, tick, tock. We need to realize that our time is running out. So you don't have time to play. You don't have time to waste. So let's live life to the fullest. But we gotta change this thing right here. It starts with the transformation. And watch this. By the what? Go back to that last one. By the renewing of our minds. You know what's important? Here it is. This is where people go back. It's the second word. They stop renewing. Renewing, ing, means it keeps going. Some of your versions say renewal. I don't like that version because renewal is final. But renewing, because another version says we have to be by the constant renewing of our minds. What that means is every day I got to renew my mind. The moment I wake up, I got to renew it. If you don't get in the word and you stop getting in the word, guess what? Renewal stops. And all of a sudden, I'm being conformed now to the patterns of the world because I stopped getting in the word. It's important that, and this is the tool. If you stop renewing, you're done. So if I stop working out, I can't just work out today and be like, I'm good. It's got to be a constant workout. I got to work out one day and 2 days and 3 days and 4 days and 5 days. Emma, they're going to this CrossFit thing. And every day she's doing her video. And they're getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm at 4 o'clock in the morning. But Emma can't just do it one day if she's going to be good. And then here's what happens. Here's what we do. We do it for 3-4 months. We get in shape. And all of a sudden what happens? We stop. And the moment you stop, go back. Don't get off that. They already know my name. By the renewing. So guess what? It never stops. If you work out, you can't ever stop working out. If you get in the word, you cannot stop ever getting in the word. I'm going on vacation, Pastor. I don't need to get in the word. Yes, you do, because you need a renewing of your mind. This is why some of you fail, because you stop renewing your mind on the word, and then the world inundates you, and you start getting caught up in the world, and you start listening to people, and they're telling you things that they shouldn't be telling you, but because you're not renewed by the thinking of your mind, because you're not in the word, you believe the lies. And you start falling for the dumb stuff that they're telling you. And you start falling for the gossiping, because you're not renewed. Here's something so vital. When somebody tells me something, because I'm in the word, I know if it's worldly or not. because I'm in the Word, I know what they're telling me is false or is accurate. Because my mind is renewed, and it's being renewed every day. This is why you have to open the Word. I don't care if you read a verse, 10 chapters. I'd rather you read a verse than 10 chapters and not understand anything. So that your mind can be what? Renewed. I got to get through this. Are you with me? So we are to be transformed. Metamorphosis only takes place if I'm renewed. My mind will always go back because 80% of your thoughts are what? Negative. So if I'm reading the Word, it's not negative. This is positive. So if I want to flip that and I want to think 80% positive thoughts, I got to be in the Word. I got to believe what God says about me. Oh, I'm going to help you with some scriptures right now. You with me? Watch this. Let's talk about this because my wife loves this next word. Let's go to the next slide. The Greek word for renewing, watch this, is anakinosis, which means renovation. I told you, my wife loves that word, renovation. Those of you that know, if you have my wife on Instagram, we have a house that's an Airbnb, that we turn into an Airbnb, and my wife loves to renovate, but she doesn't pick up a hammer. I do. She can pick up a hammer, but she's going to put holes in walls but that I don't want. But I like to make furniture, and I like to do things like that. So my wife loves to renovate. And so she's been putting the story of how we renovated this house to make it look beautiful. And so I realized when I was studying this that the Greek word for renewing, right? We got to renew what? Our minds is renovation. And so now you're getting into my language. Because I know how to renovate. I know how to do construction. And there's some men in here that have helped me. Adam was very instrumental, and Oli and Tony and who else? Lewis. Oh yeah, Lewis. He broke some walls. Other guys really helped me. And we started renovating this thing. But here's the thing about renovation. You have to see how it looks in your mind before you see it in person. You have to have a picture in your mind of the finished product, or you'll never be able to renovate it the way you want to. I need you to get this. It's important. Because some of you don't think of yourselves whole. And because you don't think of yourself whole, you stay the way you are, broken. This is why renovation is so important. Watch this. Look. Construction involving renovation often refers to restoring or repairing an existing structure, replacing the old with the new. That's what renovation means, replacing the old with the new. How fitting is that when it's a mindset? That I have to replace my old thinking with my new thinking. My old mindset with my new mindset. Come on, some of you were in drugs before, and you were in alcohol, and you were in gangs before, and you were in all these things before, but now you had to change the old to the new because you can't think like that no more. You can't be like that anymore. You can't hang around the same people anymore. Why? Because they keep you down. And so there has to be anakinosis. There has to be renovation. Let's look at what else renovation means. Let's go to the next slide. Renovation is this. Okay, let's read that. Our minds must go through a renovation. What is the last word? Process. We don't like process. I don't like process. I don't want to go through a process. No. The process of, look, there's this old man, and he's old, that I keep seeing on Instagram, and they're doing this on purpose to me. And the old man is all white hair, white beard, but he's cut up as heck. And he's got to be 60-something. And I hate that old man. Because he's making me look bad. But here's the thing about this old man. That he went through the process. And that's why he looks like that. We want the finished product, but we don't want to go through the process. I want the finished product. I want this, but I don't want to go through the sweat, the blood, the tears, the hurt, the next day waking up all sore. I don't want to go through that because I know that pain. Let me say it in biblical terms. I don't want to go through reading this thing because it's boring. Here's the problem. You're reading this thing instead of letting it read you. When it reads you, it'll tell you, son, I don't want you to think like this. Daughter, I don't want you to think like this. I have a purpose for you. Listen, if you would read scripture, it would so help you. Stop trying to read people and read the word. Our minds, say with me, my mind must go through a renovation process. It's got to go through it. If not, you're going to be living the same life over and over and over again. And by the time you think about it, you're in your 40s and 50s, and you're like, where did my life go? What did I do with my life? Why am I still in the same spot? I'm trying to help you so that you understand that God has more for you in this life. Listen, you made it. You made it. A lot of people, we know people that died through this pandemic, right? You made it. So if you made it, God has a purpose and a plan for your life. Stop believing the lies. You made it. I made it. Listen, in December, I got that thing real bad. I told you guys this story that I felt like a spirit of death walked in my house. And I heard this say to me, you're not going to make it past to 2021. And I said, devil, you're a liar. And I had my wife come and pray for me. Why? Because the devil was trying to take me out. Why? Because he knew if Reuben lives, I'm in trouble. Because Reuben understands his purpose for my life, God's purpose for his life. Reuben understands that the moment he puts his foot on the ground, I'm in trouble. And you need to understand, you have to think like that. The moment you wake up and put your foot to the ground, the devil's in trouble. Why? Because you made it, because you woke up. If you stop believing the lies, there is purpose for your life. That's why you are alive, and that's why you made it. There's people I know, two pastors that I know, a husband and a wife passed away, 55 years old, both of them. And I question, I'm just like everybody. God, why? God knows. They didn't make it, but I did. So I can't live this life purposeless. I have to live it on purpose. And I have to renew my thoughts. I have to go through the process. The process is not fun. Whoever tells you process is fun, they're lying. Process hurts. Process is not fun, but process is necessary for your life. I gotta hurry up. Here it is. Here's what renovation is. Oh, I'm going to try to get through this. Renovation refers to the process carried out to what? Come on. Some of you need an upgrade in thinking. You need an upgrade in your thinking. You need to know that you are the head and not the tail. You're above and not beneath. That's what the word says. So why am I going to think that I can't have my business and it can't explode? Listen, I'm believing that some of my business owners are going to be millionaires. Why? Because they got to fund the kingdom of God. If you have a business, listen, I got Oli sitting right here. Oli, a year and a half ago, did not have a business. Matter of fact, Oli was in a welding company for 20-something years. Oli would sit back here, and we welded everything. We'd work, and I kept telling Oli, you need to get out of that job. And Oli didn't believe in himself. But I did. And I said, you could do greater. And he got a call from his brother-in-law who has a tow company, who's had the tow company how many years? 10 years? 5 years? Seven? A long time. With one truck. And all he believed. And all of a sudden he came and he was like, Pastor, I bought my first truck. It was a rinky-dink truck. He said, Pastor, can you pray for it? I prayed for it. That first week it broke. I'm just telling you the truth. It broke. And then my dad would tell me stories of when he was a pastor in Texas, he had a guy that had a fishing business in his church, and the guy asked him to pray for the boat, and it capsized the first day that it went out to fishing. So I said, man, Dad, I got your anointing. I just be making things break when I pray for him. But it broke, and he fixed it. And then from one truck, two trucks. And then from two trucks, three trucks. From three trucks, four trucks. And now he just told me, Pastor, I'm about to get my fifth truck in a year and a half. Why am I saying that? Because if you're faithful to God, God will remain faithful to you. But there's a process you have to go through. Was it fun? Was it hard? No, he had to bust his butt. Oh, he's not lazy. Gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning doing his thing, working. That's the process. He has not stopped giving to God. Because he has not stopped giving to God, God will not stop giving to him. Not only does he have his business, his wife has a tax business. If you need your taxes done, And we also have a notary. If you need a notary, she's right here. She has her notary business. And if you need a facial, you can get your facial and your body sculpted right here. And if you need financial planning, you got financial planning here. You got everything here. What am I telling you? That it's not easy to own a business. There's a process you have to go through. It's not easy being in the job that you're in, the process that you have to go through to get promoted. But we need to upgrade. Say with me, upgrade. You have to upgrade your existing structure. That's what renovation means. To improve what? Performance. If my mind is 80% negative thinking that comes in my mind naturally, I have to improve my performance by renovation. By either altering the scope of structure, providing additional facilities, or improving. Gosh, can you understand what the word does? It does all that. It improves your mind. It improves the structure. What is the structure? My body. It's my mind. I got to get it right. Some of you are still believing the lies of what the enemy has told you because you're not in the word. I'm trying to help you. So renovation. Say with me, renovation. There's a process to renovation. My wife, as I get ready to close, there's four scriptures I want to share with you. This is really vital. But as we were doing this, I got tired. I remember Adam, we were sitting there, and Adam was just like, he's sitting on the porch. And he's like this. And I'm like, boy, that guy's a worker. And he's sitting there, I'm like, man, he's tired. A burrito ain't going to do it right now. Because that's how I paid Adam with burritos and tacos. But I realized that during the process of renovation, you're going to get tired. And that brought me a word because I was like, wow, even the strongest of us get tired. Even those that we feel like we can do it, we still get tired. And that's why I have to constantly be renewing my mind through the process of the word. You know, it's important because the question is who does God say I am? Who does God say I am? If I have to conform to the word and not conform to the patterns of this world, and I got to be transformed by the renewing of my mind, then who does God say I am? Because if I believe what God tells me I am, then I'm going to make it. Here's what God says you are in Genesis chapter 1, verse 17, real quick. It says this. It says Genesis 1, 17. It says, so God created man in his own image, in the image and likeness of God, he created him male. Oh, male and female. Go back. No. Male and female, he created them. So don't let the world tell you that a boy can be a girl and a girl can be a boy. I'm going to hit you with a word here. Well, I don't believe the word, but I do. So don't try to change my thinking. What's your pronoun? Are you a boy? You're a he. Are you a girl? You're a female. Don't let the world tell you what they are. You can tell me all you want. You can't change genetics. Okay. So what is if I read the scripture, so God created man in his own image. So here's what God, this is who I am in God. I am made in God's image. Go to that point. I'm made God's in his likeness. In other words, I thought about it. I must look like, act like, and think like my father. If I'm made in his image, in his likeness, I got to not only look like, I have to act like, and some of you look, you don't even realize it, but you act just like your parents. Some of you look like twins. Who were we with? And I was like, they are twins. I can't remember. I was like, whoa. It was the dad and the son. I was like, oh my gosh, they are twins. But then all of a sudden I heard the younger, the son speaking. I was like, wow, he sounds just like you. Why? Because he's made in the image of his father. So if God is my father, then I have to look, not only look like, but I have to act like my father. I have to talk like my father. I have to think like my father. If I'm going to be renewed, I have to think what my, and here's what it is. God told me this yesterday. I'm going to share this with you. I got to go. Sorry. I was at this event And this is what the Lord told me. God is not impressed with what impresses us. God is not impressed with what impresses you. This is what he told. He doesn't care about the lights, the glamour, the who you know. If you could just seek what the Father's heart is, it will surprise you. I'm made in God's image. And what happens is when I get around people, I want to be like them. I want to act like them. I want to think like them. But God is saying, if you would just think like me, because you're made in my image, in my likeness. You're not made in man's image. Ah. And so, I am made in God's likeness. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says it like this. Therefore, if anyone is in who? So Christ has to be in me. The new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is where? Here. So here's my second and last point. I'm a new creation. The old is gone. So my old thinking is gone. If I'm new, I can't think like the old. Here's what it says in Romans 8:1. It says this. This is so important because we sang this song at the end. Therefore, there is now no condemnation, no guilty verdict, no punishment for those who are in Christ Jesus, who believe in him as personal Lord and Savior. Therefore, there is now no condemnation. In other words, I am no longer condemned. Process. You come to the Lord, you're no longer condemned. People may condemn you, but God doesn't. He loves you. Last one. Ephesians 2:10. It says this, one of my favorite scriptures. For we are God's. Some of you don't believe that. In other words, he has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us. When? See, when are you going to live up to what God has planned for you? He planned this thing long ago. What are you waiting for? I sent my leaders a video yesterday of a pastor that thought of procrastination. Did you guys get that video? It was so vital because he says some of us procrastinate. And some of us, we're waiting on God, but there's two different things. Because we're waiting on God, some of us are actually saying we're waiting on God, but we're really procrastinating, and God is waiting on us. But we become procrastinators, so we're saying, no, but I'm just praying about it. I'm praying about it to my God. And God is saying, I'm just waiting on you. You're a procrastinator. When are you going to get up and read your word? When are you going to get up and pray just a little bit? I'm not telling you to read the whole Bible. Read a verse. Pray 30 seconds. Come on, you're watching Netflix for 20 hours straight. For we are God's what? So let me say it like this. I am, say with me, I am God's masterpiece. Period. I am God's masterpiece. So live like it. Think like it. Walk like it. Talk like it. Because this is who we are in God. So if I'm like that in God, I don't need to live beneath what my God is for me. Are you with me? Come on, let's stand to our feet real quick. Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world any longer, but the superficial values and customs be transformed and progressively changed by the renewing of your mind. Who does God say I am? I am God. I am made in God's image and his likeness. I am a new creation. The old is gone. I am no longer condemned, and I am God's masterpiece. You are God's masterpiece. These steps are going to help you to start thinking right. But you must get in the word. You must be in prayer, because the world will inundate you. And God has a purpose and a plan for your life. Will you bow your heads with me right where you're at?
Well, why don't you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video? By the way, why don't you share with your friends as well so they can enjoy these messages with you? Once again, thank you for watching. And every Sunday we're here. Join us live.